Good morning, church. How's everybody doing this morning? Hope you're doing well. You all got an extra hour of sleep. I told early service, no sleeping in church. You already got the extra hour, so the same goes for you too. Hope you're all well rested, ready to dive in this morning. Just a handful of announcements as we kick off. First of all, do not forget that tonight we do have business meeting at 6:30. There are just a handful of agenda items to cover, such as new windows on the parsonage that need to be replaced, and just a few other things, nothing truly major. But if you'd like to be here tonight at 6:30 for business meeting, we would love to see you here. Also, Bible Drillers has kicked off. Our 4th through 6th graders are meeting downstairs on Sunday mornings at 8:30. If you have any kiddos or grandkids, 4th through 6th grade, that would like to participate, I know that Miss Pat would love to have a larger crowd down there, and you can just jump on in. And so talk to Pat Barnett. She can give you more information on that if you'd like to have one of your little ones participate. And then also I'm going to have Miss Julie come and share a little bit about our Christmas gathering.
Good morning. So like I had mentioned last week, Christmas is quickly coming, which means that we are looking towards Christmas gathering. But just kind of like how 2020 has looked different in a lot of ways so far, Christmas gathering is going to look a little different too, but we're still going to move ahead with it. We had prayed about it and asked the Lord to lead us and guide us in the best way to go about this. And so we're going to be doing it online. I mentioned that last week, but I do have more details for you. So it's going to be Thursday, November 19th. At 7 p.m., and like I said, it'll be online. Tickets will be available on Sunday, the 15th of November at 2 p.m., right outside the north doors here. And it's $15 per person with a five-ticket limit per person like we've always done. But this year, we wanted to make sure that all the fun and the blessings and surprises that you typically experience when you're here can go home with you. So when you come, you'll receive a box, and we're calling it a gathering in a box. And that way, through the course of the evening of the event, you can go through with us and have all the materials that you would typically receive if you were here. So just to kind of give you an idea of what that's going to look like and everything. So you can see more details in your bulletin, but just mark your calendars, and we're excited to have this outreach. Be sure, because it is an outreach ministry, for those of you that have friends that don't know the Lord, think about them in this time. Think about maybe inviting them to participate so that way the gospel can be shared and can go out, because that's the point of the whole event. So.
Thank you, ma'am. And I do love that it's one of the largest outreach events our church does annually. And so just a fantastic way to minister to our community. And as we start talking about Christmas, I know we've mentioned the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes this morning. I've already seen some of those come back full and ready to be sent off. Continue to pray about being a part of Operation Christmas Child, again, whether as a Sunday school class or a family or as an individual, as we seek as God's people to make his name known around the world in any which way that we can. And so as we continue talking about Operation Christmas Child, I do have a video that we're going to show you guys. So if you would, direct your attention to the screen behind me, and then one of our deacons will come and pray for us.
Christian Academy loves Operation Christmas Child. It is a wonderful opportunity to teach kids how to serve others in a really tangible way.
I love everything about Operation Christmas Child. It is the lower school mission project that is run by the fourth graders. They own it. And that's part of what I love is empowering kids to understand that they can make a difference in the world.
The fourth grade classes are trying to collect 1,000 Operation Christmas Child boxes. We try to get as many people to bring boxes as we can.
We make posters encouraging people to pack boxes. And then another job is some of us go into other people's classrooms, talk about like what to bring and what not to bring. and we go out in the mornings to carpool and wave around posters and collect boxes.
And you can remind the parents to bring Operation Christmas Child boxes.
I think Operation Christmas Child is really fun because we get to help other people around the world get to know about Jesus and who Jesus was and that he died on the cross for us. We just want to help them grow in the knowledge of God.
We figured out we've collected 30,000 boxes over 20 years.
Every year we are called to be faithful and to do what we can do, one box at a time. One box can change one life.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to gather together and worship you. Father, I pray for our country and the election on Tuesday. I pray that every Christian would get out and vote to defeat the evil trying to take over our country and that your will would be done. I pray for all those living in fear of this virus right now, that they would put their trust in you and not that of man. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made.
John the Baptist said, "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I have seen and borne witness that this is the Son of God."
Jesus told the woman at the well, "I am living water. Whoever drinks the water I give will never thirst. The water I give will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life."
The Samaritan woman at the well said, "I know that the Messiah called Christ is coming, and when he comes, he'll explain everything to us." Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he."
Now we have heard Jesus for ourselves, and we know that this man is really the Savior of the world.
Jesus said, "The bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. I am the bread of life. My Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life."
I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
After Jesus healed a blind man, he asked him, "Do you believe in the Son of Man? You have seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking to you."
I tell you the truth, before Abraham was born, I am.
I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down. I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me.
Believe the miracles that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I in the Father.
Jesus loves me, you and me. Jesus loves me, you and me.
I am the resurrection and life. He who lives and believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, for whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. John 3:16.
Good morning again. At this time, would you please stand? Let's go to the Lord in worship and praise.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
You may be seated this time. At this point, I'd like to share scripture with you, and what I'd like to share is out of the book of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 9. And I don't know, Ryan's sermon series on fear and stuff, it touches home to a lot of things. But I just want to remind, Joshua reminds us that Jesus said, or he says, "Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous, do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Let us pray. Dear precious Heavenly Father, I just thank you for today, just the opportunity that you give us so we can still come here and join as one family just to worship you and praise you. And I just ask that all the trouble and what's going on in the world, just watch out for each and every one of us and just guide us and to make the decisions that we need to make. And this time I just like to lift Ryan, Brother Ryan, and his family up, their
Lord, they're suffering through a lot of stuff right now. I just ask that you just look down on them. Just lay your hand and just strengthen them and encourage them and just get them through this turmoil and just be with us as we go through the rest of the week. This is the election week. Just, we know whatever happens is your will. Just give us the wisdom to do what you need us to do. And just thanks again for everything that you've given us and everything that you've done for us. And in Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. Jesus is all I
Thank you. We're all passing the word back and forth, aren't we here? I don't think that's too bad of a thing to be doing, to be honest with you. So, I just, I really loved hearing the kids and hearing Jane take them through the scripture like she's done, teaching our next generation the word of God and being thankful. Thanksgiving really isn't that far from us, and what a way to fight stress with thankfulness. You know, so there's a lot of things that could be causing stress in your life, and then that leads to fear if you let it. And it's great to just start praising God. And I think it's great that she's teaching our children to be thankful as well. And I hope that we're doing that as parents too, not just the church, but our households are doing this as well. So Jane, thank you though for getting the kids up there and just saying all those verses. It's really sweet to see the rocks cry out. You know, the kids will cry out if... So anyhow... I got to say, I have felt many of your prayers throughout this week, and I'm pretty confident they sustained us, and it's been a rough week for Julie and I. It really has been. You know, Sunday, we headed down for the conference, and which, by the way, I got to go to the conference, but maybe for about 3 hours. It just didn't go at all the way we were planning. My sister gave me a call Saturday night. Told us, hey, mom's not doing well, and part of it's because she's just not eating. She hadn't eaten for 6 days, and they moved her from one hospital to this rehabilitation hospital. She was doing better, and then she was doing worse, and she just hadn't eaten. You know, 6 days without eating, no feeding tube or anything, will make you weak with the virus that she had. And so there was some frustration there because they had bathed my mom, and they put her in this wheelchair, and she sat there for about 8 hours, and her legs swole up really bad, and then when they brought her food, she couldn't open the saran wrap off of the food that they brought her, and she poked a hole with her fork, and her hands are shaking really bad, and she ate a couple bites, and then they took the food away and just assumed she wasn't hungry, and she didn't tell them, could you open it up for me, you know? And so my sister was telling me about what happened, and then my dad got really upset, and well, things got a lot better, actually, because he went up and talked to the administration, and so my mom, praise God, end of this week, I mean, it's a miracle she's even with us. I honestly thought she was going to pass away last Sunday, just with how pale she was, but God's a God of miracles there, and so that's one hurdle to get through. And then about 6 hours later, because we arrived late, kids slept in the van, I probably got to bed at around 2 a.m. Come Monday morning, just because we had to unpack. We didn't get in until midnight. We left late here, and I got a call at 7 a.m. from my sister to wake me up and said, "Ryan," just tears, "you got to come get me, you got to come and get the baby because I'm going to die." I'm like, "What? Marissa?" I'm still processing. I just woke up and answered the phone. "I'm really sick, Ryan, and I don't think I'm going to live through this." And just so you know, my sister's not normally like that at all, ever. And I know with just having had a baby and then her hormones are really causing a lot of anxiety in abnormal ways we weren't expecting, but she had the baby, then she went back into the hospital. Her husband has Lyme disease, and it comes in waves, and it's a really bad wave for him right now. He's just struggling to even carry himself. So Julie went and took care of the newborn, and it was a real blessing having Bridget help her out. And I took our kids. We went one way, she went the other and took care of the infant. And it's just, so we got, you know, midway through the week, it looked like they were going to be sending Marissa home. And then her dad starts struggling with constipation. And he's done this before. And we take him to the hospital Wednesday night. And then we get a phone call as I'm going in to see my mom to visit her for the week at night to let us know that her dad has stage 4 cancer of the gallbladder, and it's spread to his liver and into the lymph nodes and into just all of the organs, they said. And it's just a matter of when. It's not a matter of if anymore. And it's just, Julie's mom died of cancer too. So it's just been a whirlwind of emotions this week. I told myself I would swallow them best I could for you, you know. God's good, and your prayers have really sustained us this week, and I just want to thank you so much for your love, your cards. I'm just thankful this all happened on Pastor Appreciation Month too, you know, because your cards of love have meant a lot to hold us up, you know, so thank you for your love. I don't want to be selfish and preach on suffering. I thought about it. I thought about preaching on pain and going through it, but I don't want to be selfish in that way. I want to continue our sermon series on the fear of the Lord. And I think that this also brought me some measure of encouragement as well, just with, you know, we don't know what to expect tomorrow. We made a lot of phone calls, and just life can do that to you, just letting people know, hey, don't know when, but, and life's that way. So how do you move through life? So I'm titling this morning's message, Bury Your Fear. Bury your fear by fighting fire with fire. Fighting fire with fire. And it'll make sense. You know, there's a lot that I think has caused stress this year. The death toll is rising. Lockdowns have continued. They've talked about returning them. I remember people were concerned when they were forced to go back to work. Didn't want to return to work out of fear of being sick. We've got through that. Now the stock market has crashed and come back and crashed again. Panicked buying at the supermarket. We've had hospitals overcrowded. We've had protests and riots. We've had the new people talk about new viruses and further outbreaks happening on the horizon. And who would have thought that 2020 would be a year filled with so much anxiety? I mean, last year, you look at what people were concerned about, their biggest concern was healthcare. Now, there's so much more, from people being afraid, leading to anger, and then to hatred. And I think that's part of it. We have got to keep our fears in check, or we will become a very irritable, angry, hateful people. And God doesn't want us to live that way. Not with bitterness. It's not right. So, how do we stop it before it starts? Fear. How do we overcome this fear? How can we bury it? When I talk about burying, I mean you dig a hole, and then you throw the dirt back on top of it and bury it. How do we do that? How do we do it biblically? And that's what I want to look at in the Word of God this morning. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we are tremendously thankful to be gathered in your house today, to get to gather as a body of believers, to love you, to worship you together. It's a privilege to be with the body. I pray that, Father, you would bless us as we're gathered, that this morning's message would be edifying, that you would stir our soul and lead us to peace with you. My prayer is that as we now turn to your word, that your spirit would anoint this room, anoint me, and may we be able to sit at your feet and learn and grow. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I thought I'd begin with Isaiah 33:6, which says, "And he will be the stability of your times, abundance of salvation, wisdom, and knowledge. The fear of the Lord is Zion's treasure." Treasure. So there's this element of, do you want stability in your life? Do you want peace in your life? He's talking about having an abundance of salvation. And there's this treasure, this gem that Zion has, the city of God. It's the fear of the Lord. Have you ever thought about the fear of the Lord as a treasure? As a most precious gem that you should protect and hold on to? The fear of the Lord. It's a gift of God. That's what the Bible is saying right here. So Isaiah is teaching. He's teaching the people of Israel that God will be their stability, and it's wrapped up within a healthy fear of the Lord. Walking in fear of the Lord. So that's the key. That's the key to peace, having this respect and awe of God. How do we do this then? I want to talk about answering that question. How do we biblically bury our fear? Three principles that we'll reflect on. First, we have to understand that the person who fears God will fear nothing else. Do we understand that? If you fear God biblically, you won't be afraid of anything else. When your heart's right, when it's settled on the Lord. Matthew 10:26-28, listen to Jesus' words. "So have no fear of them. Have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say it in the light. And what you hear whispered, proclaim it on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul." Don't fear people. "Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell." Don't fear people. Fear the Lord instead. Do you see what Jesus is doing here? He's fighting fire with fire. When we are afraid, we fight fear with fear. When we are afraid of people, when we are afraid of all these other issues that can cause anxiety, we need to remind ourselves to fear the Lord, who is capable, who is supreme, and there's nothing he can't handle. So we turn to him. You know, I think there's one common feature that's shared amongst fear, and in particular, the fear of people. Do you know what that one common characteristic is? I think it's when we make people too big. We make them too big. We make them so big that we become idolatrous about it. We begin to be consumed and controlled by their thoughts of us and what they think about us. That it's almost like we're worshiping their opinion more than we worship God's opinion of us. To know that God is awesome and people are not. They're not. Is to get a healthy respect and alignment of your fear of God first. Now, God made people for us to love. But there's only one who is holy, one who is pure. And that's the Father, and that's where our fear should begin first, to walk in the fear and admonition of the Lord. I think we've become really consumed with ourselves. Self-improvement. By the way, that's not bad. I don't mean to be knocking self-improvement. I think it's great when one of our kids goes off to college or when one of them decides to take the HVAC test because they want to know heating and cooling systems to better their life. I mean, I think that's great when a dad looks up for the first time how to change a diaper online, right? I mean, we all got to start somewhere. Just little things. How do I do that? It's okay to improve yourself. It's not okay when all of your self-improvements are solely for yourself and not for the glory of God. I think we live in a culture that just makes it all about self, self-improvement, self-esteem, selfies on Facebook. How much self can we throw into this? How much human worship can we give ourselves and others? But we should start first with the fear of the Lord, to fear Him and walk rightly before Him. There seems to be this sort of contradiction in the scripture. Ecclesiastes 12:13 says, "The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of a man." That's your duty. Fear God. Keep His commandments. And when you can't do that, you're failing at your duty to the Lord. But then there's this other passage, 1 John 14, which says, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear." How is the Bible saying to fear God, and then at the same time, there's no fear in love? I think he answers his own question if you continue to read, so I won't stop there. It says, "For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love." Well, he's answering you. He's saying that when you continue to live in fear, then you don't have perfect love. It starts with a bit of fear. Wisdom begins with fear. When you look at the Lord, there should be this awe that strikes you, this holy fear, as you try to understand what exactly is He. He's not like me. He's transcendent and holy and perfect and morally pure, and I'm not. I'm not. So there's this fear. And by the fact, when we try to define the word fear of the Lord, what is the fear of the Lord? What is that? Well, there's a couple attributes that come to it. One, there is terror. Yeah, terror, threat, fear. He is powerful and threatening, because you are a finite being standing before the infinite God who created the mountains and the ocean, you in the expanse of the universe, and you don't hold a candle to His glory. So there is this component. And by the way, if you haven't surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, this threat fear will come for you on Judgment Day when you stand before a holy God. You'll feel that sense of terror before you, and it's too late. But then there's this other side that the Bible talks about of fear, and believers who have surrendered to Christ understand this, that yes, though you began your walk with fear of Him, you learned very quickly that God actually begins with, "I love you first. I love you first." A believer who has surrendered to Jesus Christ realizes that they've got a Father who loves them, and they didn't need to be afraid of Him. They need to just trust Him. It's kind of like being a kid with your dad. Hopefully you've had some measure of a healthy relationship with your dad growing up. But when I think about my dad, he's not somebody I want to make angry. Definitely when I was a kid. He's not somebody I wanted to poke the bear, okay? He's dad. And at the same time, there was something special about my dad when he took me to soccer games, football games, Boy Scout outings, and to just be able to sit in his arms and then protect me. It's something similar to that with God. Don't take him trivially. Don't trifle with him. But know that he'll protect you and he loves you. He cares about you. So that's what 1 John's getting at. The unbeliever has a terror and a fear, and they'll have that with God. But the believer has a worshipful fear and reverence of God. They understand. They understand this. If you would fear God properly, you'll fear nothing else. You won't. Because you know he's got it, whatever comes your way, and you can rest in that peace. Now, secondly, we also learn that the fear of God can be taught to you. You can learn the fear of God. And I know there's some of you in the church who haven't been living with the fear of God. It's not something that really comes to your mind on a daily basis. You don't wake up in the morning with a holy awe of the Lord. Every decision you make, the Lord watches. And it doesn't have any bearing on your day-to-day life. And it's easy for any of us to slip into that. Deuteronomy 4:10 says you can learn it if you don't have it. You can learn this. How on that day, Deuteronomy 4:10, you stood before the Lord your God at Horeb, the Lord said to me, gather the people to me, that I may let them hear my words so that they may learn to fear me all the days that they live on the earth, and that they may teach their children to gather the people up, bring them to me, that I might teach them the fear of the Lord, and also teach their children too. So this is something you can learn if you don't have it. If you've been living your life, it's not too late for you. You can learn the fear of the Lord and to live in his admonition. Psalm 34:11, come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. I will teach you. So what's the issue? I think it's not easy. It's not easy to learn because reading your Bible consistently is not that easy. When you come to the scripture and you start to actually read your Bible, this is a big book, I know. It's actually many books in one. It's massive. It's thousands of pages and it's intimidating. But if you will pick it up and read it, you'll begin to experience this holy fear of God, that you stand before a holy being and you want to walk properly for his glory. But you got to read this. So you can't, I know it's hard to learn because it's hard to make yourself read the word. Two concepts that need reconciling. Psalm 118:4, let those who fear the Lord say his steadfast love endures forever. There's love comes with fear. His steadfast love endures forever. Those who fear him, if you fear him, you know his love. There's love. Psalm 76:7, but you are to be feared. Who can stand before you when your anger is roused? Wow. There's this sort of fear of him that's a scary fear of God. And then there's this other kind of fear that brings love. There's reconciling that happens here. Like I said, you don't really understand it till you become born again. It's like trying to describe the Holy Spirit to a person who's not born again. Well, what is the Holy Spirit? Well, live in you? Well, how does that work? Well, they talk to you? He leads you with conviction? You can't do it. You just got to become born again. And then this makes sense, what he's saying. You cannot, by the way, say rightly, it's not biblical for you to say, my God is not a God of anger. He's only a God of love. You can't say that and be right biblically. The Bible teaches God is a God of anger. Actually, it just takes sin lightly when people say that. It suggests that, oh, God's a God of love. He's just saddened by your sin. He's not offended by it. But he's holy. He's morally pure, and you're not. He is offended at sin, and the scriptures teach it repeatedly. Now, on the other hand, you can't swing the pendulum the other way and say, my God is only a God of anger and not love. If you go that route, now he becomes somebody you are terrified of, and you don't even want to go to him. You're looking to run the other way and hide in a hole somewhere, and you want to avoid God. God loves you. He doesn't want you to avoid him. He wants you to come before him, but he also wants you to have a respect and fear and admonition for him. So there's a balance that comes with this. The scripture's always teaching balance. I know, when you struggle with having no fear of God, you can find it in creation. You can absolutely find it in creation. Psalm 33, 8 through 9 says, let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke, and it came to be commanded, and it stood firm. He created all the mountains. He created the universe. He creates the expanse, the ocean, all of this stuff that you can't even comprehend with the molecules that are in this room, the oxygen you're breathing in your lungs, where did it come from? How did he set it all up? How do you exist? How do you sit on that pew and not fall through the core of the earth? How did he write all these laws and rules? But he did, because he's infinitely intelligent. And when you look at creation, you should stand in awe and have a fear of God, because he is capable of things you can't possibly imagine. I remember the first time I saw the mountains. Heading out to Colorado over 10 years ago, maybe 20 years ago, I remember on the horizon, you could slowly start to see the peak of a mountain. You barely make it out. Is that what I think it is? Is that a mountain? That can't be. Is it a cloud? I mean, I remember as we drove closer and closer to Colorado, you could start to really see the mountains, and a lot of you have experienced this, I think. Then you get closer and closer and closer. They get bigger and bigger and bigger. And before you know it, the mountains are rolling on and on and on. What seems like forever, there's streams and wildlife. You could just get lost in the majesty of God with how he made all of this. And it's like you stand at the pinnacle of creation when you get to the mountaintops and you're looking down at all of what God has created. I remember seeing how blue the ocean was for the first time in Haiti, it just took my breath away. There we are on a mission trip, and it's an island, so the ocean's just all around you. And there's these people you're trying to reach who, they are people, you know, and they're, some of them are living in stick huts, some of them aren't, some of them have like an apartment, but they're a lot more poor than we are. And they've got this beautiful, gorgeous ocean wrapped all around their island. You know, I thought the movies were lying. I mean, there's no way it's that blue. And then I saw it for myself. It took my breath away, and I remember having a fearful respect of that gorgeous looking ocean. Now, because there's creatures out there floating out there that could get you, right? But because the sheer vastness of all that water, you could be swept away and drowned to death. How many of you would be willing to just start swimming off the banks of the ocean and keep going? Even the lifeguard tells you, don't go too far, because there's a point you can swim so far out, the waves will just take you away. We won't know where you are, and you can drown to death. That's the power of God. He made all that water, all those mountains. And you, when you look at creation, should have a fear of God on your heart. What he is capable of. Psalm 104, 5 through 10, he set the earth on its foundation so that it should never be moved. You covered it with the deep as with a garment. The water stood above the mountains. At your rebuke, they fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took flight. The mountains rose. The valleys sank down to the place that you appointed for them. You set a boundary that they may not pass, so that they might not again cover the earth. Or there's the way that Elizabeth Barrett wrote, Elizabeth Barrett Browning. She writes, "Earth's crammed with heaven, and every bush afire with God, but only he who sees takes off his sandals. The rest sit around and pluck blackberries." Do you see it? Or are you just living your day-to-day life? You can see how God is powerful in creation. Now, lastly, we need to see that the fear of the Lord is a beautiful concept. To fear God is beautiful. The scriptures always teach this. It's not something we should run from. It's something we should be proud of. The Bible speaks frequently, Proverbs 9:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. It gives you spiritual peace. Proverbs 19:23. The fear of the Lord leads to life, and whoever has it rests satisfied. He will not be visited by harm. You have the fear of God, you're satisfied in your soul, and there's a confidence that will come to you if you fear God first. Or how about Proverbs 31:30? Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. This is the kind of woman, men, you want to marry. Proverbs 31 is about the ideal woman. And I know it's hard, ladies, to read that and want to measure up to that. Well, the perfect woman has a fear of God, and it should be praised when she fears the Lord. Just imagine what life would be like if we feared God. All the marital fights, maybe they would lead with love, ask forgiveness and understanding rather than abandon one another. Maybe if we actually loved in the schoolyard, kids wouldn't make fun of each other and gossip and rant, but they would tell great stories about the other kids, good stories, because they feared God. Maybe we wouldn't want to murder somebody in our heart when they do something that makes us so angry we want revenge. Maybe if we feared God, we might just cover it up with love and forgiveness instead. That's what he did for us, isn't it? Isn't that the gospel? When I am scared, the majesty of God is encouraging. I've had a lot this week to dwell on. I don't know what's going to happen with my mom or Julie's dad. I want Lydia to know her grandpa. She's probably not going to know him. I know. Talked about maybe we make a video, maybe we don't, but this is God's decision. Job helps me here with the majesty of God. Job 38:12 says, "Have you commanded the morning since your days began and caused the dawn to know its place?" Ryan, do you make the sun rise? No, Lord, I don't. I don't. "Have the gates of death been revealed to you, or have you seen the gates of deep darkness? Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth? Declare it if you know all of this." No, I can't. "Can you send forth lightning?" Job 38:35. "That may go and say to you, 'Here we are.'" No, God, I can't do that either. Maybe you should just trust me. "What can I do but what Job does in 42:6? Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." Created order with what God can do. It's amazing how God will take his beauty to give us courage when we're afraid. Like he does with Isaiah. Remember, he sees the train of God, the whole room filled with his glory. "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." I remember the day that I took my little girl Bridget out, spent the whole day with her. I was busy working and I laid down the sermon writing, and normally a thing like that would kind of aggravate me, but she said, "Dad, can we hang out?" And we went and shot hoop at the basketball court, and we walked around the neighborhood and rode a bike. She rode the bike, I walked alongside of her, and we played a board game together. We just spent the whole day together, and she wrote me this card that said, "Dear Daddy, I love you so, 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 so much. XOXOXOXOXO." And it took up the whole page and even went to the back of the page that she wrote. And I think I understood the power of repetition when God says, "I am holy, 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 declares the Lord God Almighty. I am so holy, so, 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 so holy, unlike you." And it makes sense to me when I think of it in that way. You can face the trouble in your life when you understand how God is holy. And I want to end with this thought. Tomorrow when you punch your time card, I want you to do it with the fear of God on your heart. When you coach the little league, coach them with the fear of God on your heart. And when you vote on Wednesday, vote with the fear of the Lord upon your heart. Walk in the fear of the Lord, and you will find rest and peace for your soul. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word this morning and having the chance to reflect. Father, we have so many burdens and fears to overcome. Lord, teach our church to fear you. Sadly, your grace is not always amazing to us. We can be slow to hate our sin. We're moved more by the concern of what others will think of us when we should be more concerned with what you think of us. Lord, we want to delight in your reverential fear. We want to revere you. We want to treasure it. We want to give it to the next generation. You are an all-consuming, all-powerful God who loves us. You are majestic and beautiful, and your glory is like no other. Teach us to trust you. If there's anybody who's scared, something on their heart, I don't know what it is, it could be anything, would they be able to lay the burden down and come to the cross? Father, I pray that somebody in this room would for the first time have a fear and respect for you and realize their desperate need for Jesus. And would they come to him and believe and find peace in your loving arms? It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church family, I just want to continue to encourage you to fight fire with fire, to bury your fears in the fear of the Lord. I know you might have an anxious week this week. It could go any way, any direction. You could have personal issues come up, but there is the Lord, and he is capable. Let's all rise, and we're going to sing a final song together, and we'll be dismissed.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.